these things were not beneficial, but back in the day, they thought they were. So, let us begin. This is already looking pretty bad. Why are you drilling into somebody's brain? Just a standard drill. What's going on here? Okay. Here we are. Boom, boom, boom. For as long as human beings have been around, they have been getting ill, injuring themselves, and contracting diseases. Physicians have been concocting tinctures and performing surgeries to alleviate these ailments for just as long. However, while we are lucky today to be alive in a time of great scientific and medical knowledge, that was unfortunately not always the case. Throughout history, going to the doctor was often more risky than just taking your chances with your illness. Yeah. Poor hygiene standards, toxic medicines, and a general misunderstanding of human anatomy all led to some crazy. Cures only ended up causing their ailing patients more harm than intended. Anyway, without further ado, there are 8 old medical practices that did more harm than good. Oh boy, this should be fun. Imagine, it's just like, yeah, stay home. Surviving that way, going to the doctor and having them stick a rusty needle in your arm or something. I don't know. All right, let's do it. Number 1, corpse medicine. Now, already sounding very, very fun. For hundreds of years, European physicians believed that a whole host of human maladies could be cured by. Oh, brother, we're starting off strong. Peaking in popularity in the 16th and 17th centuries, doctors prescribed everything from blood to ground-up skulls to their patients. With what evidence? Oh my goodness. When rubbed on the outside of the body, it was believed that human fat could relieve aches and cure gout. While a tincture of ground-up skull with alcohol could help cure epilepsy. Okay, alright, but you try this on enough people and they still have epilepsy, then you're like, okay, then it doesn't work, right? To keep trying it, they need to grind up skull their bodies for, well, not grind up skull, but a mixture of ground up skull and alcohol. You need to put that on your bodies for okay, consuming fresh blood, oh brother, was thought to aid in general health and vitality. So they're just passing diseases around. Oh my goodness. Everyone from lay people to royalty believed in the idea that corpses retained the spirit of the person who had passed. Therefore, anyone who consumed human remains could gain some of their former strength. As gruesome as it might sound, corpse medicine remained a popular course of treatment for centuries, with the last known occurrence happening in 1908. The last known. It's not to say that some people weren't still doing some sneaky stuff in their basements. Look. Okay, so the spirit of the person was retained in the corpses, right? Now, that's all. You know what? I don't know. This just sounds so ridiculous. So very ridiculous. Please do not eat people. Okay? Don't eat people. All right. lesson about using potentially toxic elements as a curative tonic. However, that, unfortunately, wasn't the case. Radium, another dangerous element, was commonly mixed with water, sold as an over-the-counter energy drink in the early 20th century. Radium water was marketed under the name brand Adathor, with the slogan, "A cure for the living dead." Wait, zombies? This was a cure for zombies. Vitality, really, and cure impotence in men. Oh man, despite the fact that the adverse health effects of radium were already known as early as 1913, Adathor remained a popular drink through the 1920s until the federal government forced an end to its production in 1932. That's not that long ago. I know humans are dumb. I know it. I do. But, I mean, I guess it doesn't matter. Because to this day, some people are just not going to believe certain things, you know. It is what it is, I guess. It's just unfortunate when other people start getting affected by this stuff. Anyway, number four. Antimony. I don't know what that is. Robert James, an 18th century English physician, invented and patented his famous Dr. James's fever powder in 1747. Dr. James claimed his concoction could treat any number of ailments, including fever, scurvy, and even distemper. I was reading ahead to see if they tell us what antimony is, okay? But he was notoriously secretive about the recipe of his fever powder. As it turned out, the secret ingredient was antimony, a toxic metal. Well, that's what it is. Now we all know. Well, Jerome probably knew, but as for the rest of us, I'm kidding. You all are very smart. I'm the only one that didn't know, surely. Typically, it says contact a poison center immediately if you ingest anything. But, I mean, now that you know all the things, your body does eat something it doesn't like when you get food poisoning or something, maybe you'll throw up or poop it out or whatever, but that's your body telling you, hey, we don't like what's in here, man. Eat something bad. Get it out. But, that's when you unknowingly eat something bad, right? That's what happens to you humans. You just expel it one way or the other. But in this case, you're eating poison. You're doing it to yourself. And then your body is rejecting it. Not because you ate a bad piece of meat, because you ingested poison. Just straight poison. What do you do? All right, Trepanation is one of the oldest medical practices in human history. For over 5,000 years, humans have attempted to cure head pain, skull trauma, and even neurological diseases by drilling holes in the patient's skull. Less extreme versions involved simply scraping or cutting smaller sections of the skull. Evidence of trepanation has been found worldwide, including Europe, China, Russia, and the Americas. A modern version of trepanation still exists in medicine, now called a craniotomy. It's only done to treat extreme conditions, such as a brain tumor. The skull fragments are immediately replaced. Yeah. These people just drilling holes, and the thing is, back then, how do you have the technology to know when to stop? Like, what if they, I'm sure, actually, not what if, like, they had to have drilled some holes in people's brains. And then, when that person was now acting worse than before because you drilled a hole in their brain, like their actual brain, not just the skull. Pressure on that drill, you know, to get it to start going through the skull. And then once it breaches the skull, it's very, very soft brain that gets touched by the drill necks. Oh man, they messed up a lot of people back in the day. Oh my goodness, it's ridiculous. Ridiculous. Okay, number six. Arsenic. Bro, brother, arsenic is another very ancient medicine dating all the way back to Hippocrates. The father of medicine himself used the metalloid to treat ulcers and other sores. From ancient Greece to ancient China, arsenic was valued for its medicinal properties. It was believed to be able to restore health. Made into tinctures to treat several diseases, from opened wounds and ulcers to sleeping sickness. In 1786, an enterprising doctor named Thomas Fowler manufactured his own arsenic-based remedy and began bottling and selling it under the name Fowler's Solution. Fowler's Solution was sold through the 20th century as a cure for conditions like asthma, and heartburn, and it was even used in the treatment of leukemia. Look, man, I mean, we're not doing it today, right? We're not doing it today, so. What do you think that means? Are you going to your doctor and having them prescribe arsenic? Just another one of these chemical elements, you know, that's ultimately not good for you, I'm sure, you know. A high amount of arsenic can be bad for you. Straight up kill you if you ingest too much arsenic. You know? I'm just always baffled by this stuff. Let's just keep going. Bloodletting. Number 7. As early as 3,000 years ago, ancient Egyptians pioneered the practice of bloodletting, using a lancet or leeches to open a patient's veins and draw out their practice spread to ancient Greece and continued to be a popular practice in Europe and America all the way up until the late 1800s. In medieval Europe, physicians believed that the body consisted of four humors: blood, phlegm, saying that childbirth are they saying that childbirth was an illness? Is that what's happening here? Am I just confused? Come on, really? Childbirth was a malady. No, it's not an illness. I've seen pictures, videos of people putting leeches on themselves to suck the blood out. Like, it's all really ridiculous. It's really ridiculous, you know? It's childbirth. Created by the German physician Franz Anton Mesmer in the 1770s. Animal magnetism was the belief that the planets exude magnetic rays, which influence human health via an invisible magnetic fluid that permeates the human body. Mesmer believed that illness was caused when a person's magnetic fluid was blocked or unbalanced. Okay, by using magnets along with certain hand gestures, Mesmer claimed he could unblock an ill person's magnetic fluid and restore health. A man was using spare fingers to to cure people. Special hand movements. Okay. Success was also short-lived. Following a scandal involving one of his blind patients in 1778, Mesmer's reputation was ruined and animal magnetism fell out of fashion. However, mesmerism is also sometimes considered the precursor to a practice that we are all familiar with today, the art of hypnosis. History of medicine is full of crazy, questionable, and sometimes downright dangerous practices. But at the time, most doctors truly believed they were doing the best they could to heal their patients. It makes one wonder, what will historians say about our modern medical practices 100 years from now? And that's true. It's going to be some stuff that's seen as archaic. Imagine some guy just waving his fingers in front of you like, you're healed. But here's the thing. This one might be the least. Okay, maybe not the... It's not like you're ingesting poison like some of these other ones, because there have been proof of some sort of hypnosis being helpful for humans, you know? So, Mesmer have been onto something. Just how? But the magnets and the hand gestures, you know, there's something to some of it. I don't know about the magnets, but if it's a precursor to hypnotism, then there's actually some proof out there, some studies that might back up some benefits of certain types of hypnotism. But yeah, that's it. Please let me know what you think of all this stuff in the comments below. you think of this stuff in the comments below. Would you have just stayed home and just dealt with your illness back in the day? Or would you have risked it and had some, what was it, radithor? Is that what it was? I remember. Or some arsenic.